In the first video of this series, we talked about how dietary habits have changed over the last 12,000 years, since the Paleolithic period. To put it simply, they changed a lot. Today, 71% of typical Western diet consists of foods that were not available to humans 12,000 years ago. Last week, we discussed 7 diet categories. Today and next week, we'll talk about specific diets. And the first diet that we'll discuss is, you guessed it, the Paleolithic diet, or usually called the Paleo diet in short. Coming up! Hi, Andre here. Welcome to the Practical Health Channel. The Paleolithic diet is essentially aims to recreate the diet that humans followed during the Paleolithic era. This period is also called the Old Stone Age and started about 2.5 million years ago and ended in 10,000 BC. The good thing is that the modern version of this diet doesn't have you eating woolly mammoth. In modern times, the Paleolithic diet as a concept started in the 1970s, and its popularity soared after the publication of the book The Paleo Diet, Lose Weight and Get Healthy by Eating the Food That We're Designed to Eat, by Lauren Corden in 2002. According to Google Trends, the popularity peak of this diet happened in 2014. Since then, there has been a gradual decline, but still remains a quite a popular diet today. The Paleo diet relies on natural foods that our ancestors ate during the Paleolithic era. This means the exclusion of processed meats, dairy, refined sugars, and grain-based foods. They didn't have candy bars or margaritas during the Old Stone Age. The Paleo diet has a lot of benefits. You're more likely to eat foods without additives, preservatives, or chemicals. Paleo is a diet with a healthy level of vitamins and minerals, and a diet without processed foods, like refined sugars. One of the main criticisms of the Paleo diet is that its restrictiveness makes it difficult to sustain, and the exclusion of entire food groups like dairy and grains make it hard for dieters to get all the nutrients they need. The typical Paleo diet can create a risk of deficiencies in calcium and vitamin D, which are critical for bone health. For short term, Paleo helped healthy subjects and even diabetic patients re-establish their normal glycemic levels. However, this diet is difficult to sustain for overall health in the long term. Let's move on. According to Google Trends, the most searched diet these days is the vegetarian diet. Vegetarianism is the practice of abstaining from the meat, red meat, poultry, seafood, and the flesh of any other animals, and may also include abstention from byproduct of animal slaughter. The strongest form of vegetarianism is veganism, the practice of abstaining from any use of animal products. According to Google Trends, the vegan diet is also getting popularity these days. The key argument of proponents of vegetarianism is that humans are herbivores, and the vegetarian diet is a natural fit for us. So, let's spend a couple minutes talking about human physiology and anatomy, and let's see if it's appropriate to categorize humans as herbivores, or we're closer to carnivores, animals that get food from killing and eating other animals. Let's compare our digestive system to the ones of herbivores and carnivores. Are we closer to a cute pony or a ravenous lion? First, the length of the digestive tract. Humans have an about 7-to-1 digestive tract length to the body size ratio. Carnivorous mammals average around 4-to-1, while monogastric herbivores typically have around 12-to-1. So the human digestive tract is somewhere in the middle between the ones of herbivores and the one of carnivores. By the way, humans do not possess multiple stomachs as some herbivores like cows do. I wish I had multiple stomachs. That would be so much fun. The next comparison point is teeth and saliva. A strong anthropological argument is the fact that our teeth did not evolve to pierce and shred meat, like the teeth of ravenous lions did, but to grind, just like a cute pony calmly chewing its daily hay. Herbivores usually grind side to side the food they chew, while carnivores have an up and down motion. Humans can do both, so again, falling somewhere in between. Carnivores have small salivary glands that produce no enzymes at all. But humans with large, well-developed parotid glands and submandibular glands that produce a mostly serous saliva share more traits with herbivores, at another point of the cute pony category. Next, the acidity of the stomach. The human stomach requires a very acidic pH of 1.5 to 2.5 to maintain digestive health, similar to carnivores. Meanwhile, herbivores 3.3 to 7.3. This pH is vital to chemically break proteins down into peptides and amino acids, which facilitate the absorption of said molecules. Here humans are closer to the carnivores, point ravenous line. Another comparison point is stomach capacity. Carnivorous mammals, 60 to 70% of total volume of digestive tract. Herbivores, less than 30%. Humans, about 25% of the total volume of digestive tract. So here we line up closer to the cute ponies again. Let's keep going, this is fun. The ability to digest fiber. Humans cannot digest fiber like herbivores because the necessary enzymes to break down the beta-acetyl linkages are not available in humans or carnivores. These beta-acetyl linkages, simply put cellulose, is chemically very similar to starch but harder to break down. The enzyme cellulase is needed in addition to 27 million bacteria to do the job. Yeah, you need 27 million microscopic living creatures inside you to digest grass and leaves. Our stomachs and small intestines are mostly sterile, similar to the carnivores and opposite to the herbivores. In this case, humans are back in that lion territory again. The next category is the complete digestion time and absorption rate. It's 24 to 48 hours for herbivores and 6 to 10 hours for carnivores. For humans, the complete digestion time ranges from 12 to 18 hours. Herbivores have a 50% absorption rate. This is why a longer passage of nutrients through the intestines is needed. Again, we're somewhere in the middle between herbivores and carnivores. As you can see, there are good arguments on both sides, and we can continue this list. For example, humans cannot produce vitamin C on their own. We can only derive it from plant sources. Carnivores and some omnivores produce their own vitamin C. On the other side, humans cannot synthesize own vitamin B12. That's why vitamin B12 is usually sourced from animal foods, such as liver, fish, chicken, and eggs. So there's no consensus here, and this topic remains a highly debated one even today. Personally, I tend to feel more like a cute pony in the morning and more like a ravenous lion by nightfall. The bottom line is that the human digestive system is somewhere between herbivores and carnivores. There's a lot of bias in the scientific world towards either an herbivore or carnivore approach, both having pros and cons. So, no surprise that humans are omnivores. Going back to the vegetarian diet, it has a lot of benefits. Since the diet relies on plant-based food, it's full of vitamins and minerals and can help lower cholesterol and blood pressure, aiding in the prevention of heart disease. Additionally, vegetarian food is fiber-rich, which helps regulate bowel movements, prevent constipation, and reduce the risk of colon cancer. But to be objective, it has its own disadvantages. Since the diet excludes all animal products, it can lack calcium, omega-3 fatty acids, vitamin B12, and folate, all of which are available in meat and dairy. By the way, there are some so-called semi-vegetarian diets. One of them is flexitarianism, a diet centered around plant foods with the occasional inclusion of meat. This diet doesn't have any specific rules or suggestions, making it an appealing option for people who are looking to cut back on animal products. Another one is pescatarianism. Pesca means fish in the Italian language. This diet incorporates seafood as the only source of meat in otherwise vegetarian diet. There are a couple more semi-vegetarian diets. Palatarian diet. This diet permits to eat chicken and other poultry and usually eggs. Kangetarian diet is a recent practice of following a diet which excludes meat except the meat of kangaroo. It was introduced in 2010 and is, as you might guess, far more popular in Australia than anywhere else. Also, a couple words on the raw food diet. Peter Unger from the University of Oxford, in his book Evolution of Human Diet from 2007, wrote that the human digestive system evolved past eating raw food. He claims that humans are not known to survive on raw food. Foods, in most circumstances, had to be cooked. The theory behind the impossibility of humans eating entirely raw are based on the premise that we have small guts, and on the top of that, we also possess a fast gut rate passage, which is very fast compared to our distant relative, the ape. That means that our digestive organs are insufficient and do not provide the adequate time for the absorption of nutrients. Anthropological studies have revealed that humans are very similar to the animals that break down their food with their hands before injecting them, like the cebus or papio. We adapted so much to the easily absorbable nutrient that our digestive system shrank down and simply forgot how to walk on raw food. We might never forget how to ride a bicycle, but we can forget how to eat raw food. So that's it for today. To recap, today we discussed the paleo diet and its pros and cons, vegetarian and vegan diets, and we learned that our digestive system is somewhere in the middle between the digestive systems of herbivores and carnivores. Also, our digestive system evolved past eating raw food. Next week, we'll talk about other popular diets, ketogenic, intermittent fasting, and many others. See you next week. Bye.